Hello everyone, Stepan here. Today I'll continue the Sicilian series with the Sveshnikov Sicilian, which is probably one of the most popular variations on the highest grandmaster level. Not as popular as the Nidor or as the Dragon Sicilians perhaps, but it's somewhere out there at the top. The variation used to be called the Lasker-Pelikan variation, and some people still refer to it that way even today. Because it was pioneered by Emanuel Lasker at the beginning of the 20th century, and Jorge Pelikan used to play it in the 50s, but nobody really attributed to the theory of the opening as much as Evgeny Sveshnikov. Evgeny Sveshnikov is a strong grandmaster still, and he popularized the opening in the 70s, and together with Gennady Timoshenko, he was the pioneer of the modern Sveshnikov, I would say. So I think it's just to call the variation Sveshnikov Sicilian today. So, okay, let's get into the opening. So after e4, c5, the Sicilian defense, knight to f3, knight to c6, d4, c takes d4, knight takes d4. If you are interested in the Kalashnikov or the Löwenthal variations, you should check out the video I put in the description below. Black would play e5 here immediately, that would be the Kalashnikov or the Löwenthal. You can see that in the description below, the video I made on that. But today we are going to focus on the Sveshnikov. So here black doesn't dislodge the knight from d4 immediately. He plays knight to f6, putting pressure on the e-pawn. Defending the pawn with f3 is playable. It's dubious, but it's playable. But the main move is knight to c3. And here in this position, black goes for a very aggressive central pawn push, e5, same as in the Kalashnikov variation. But here the situation is different because the knights have been placed on f6 and c3. So black is forcing the white knight to move. That much is clear. Now, moving the knight to e2, to b3, or to f3 doesn't really work. And black is accepting a lot of weaknesses in the center to get the initiative in the opening, to get an opening advantage to fasten his development. And placing the knight either to e2, b3, or f3 would play into black's hands and give him just the time he was wanting to get with the aggressive move e5. Now, once black plays e5, two things are clear. He's leaving himself with a backward d-pawn, which is most probably going to end up on d6 and be a permanent weakness in the position. And the second key factor that arises from the move e5 is the weakness on d5. And in the Sicilian defense, of course, once you trade your c-pawn, you don't have as much control on the d-file. And once you play your pawn to e5, then d5 is a permanent weakness, which can no longer be contested by any pawn. Of course, neither by the c-pawn nor by the e-pawn. So you can imagine several pieces coming into d5 later on. It would be perfect to situate the knight there. In the Sveshnikov, a key maneuver is something along the lines of the knight coming to c2, then coming to e3, and then putting pressure on the d5 square. So black is playing e5 to gain time and to gain initiative, but he's leaving himself with two permanent positional weaknesses. One weak square, one horribly weak square on d5, and one very weak pawn on d6 usually. Now the thing is that white can white can't usually exploit both, because if you want to occupy the d5 square, then you can't really put pressure on d6. And if you want to pressurize the d6 pawn, then you can't really occupy the d5 square. So, yeah. So as I said, moving the knight into f3, e2 or b3 is too passive, and it gives black exactly what he wants. One other move which shouldn't really be played is the move knight to f5, which is sort of challenging, even though not really, because black gets to push d5 immediately, and now after e takes d5, your knight is hanging, but you are attacking black's knight in a turn. So e takes d5, bishop takes f5, and now d takes c6, and b takes c6 would leave black with a quite okay position. If you turned on the engine here, this is just slightly better for white. It's almost completely equal, and white has basically given up his opening advantage. If you let the engine run a little deeper, then now it already gives black a slight edge. But as I said, white is basically giving up his opening advantage with the move knight to f5, so that shouldn't really be played, because black can immediately strike in the center with d5, and that would solve both of his problems provoked with the move e5. It gets rid of the weak d pawn and it strengthens the d5 square. So if you play knight to f5, both problems which arise for black after the move e5 are solved. So don't play knight to f5. So the only move after e5, the only move that's played, there are about 20,000 grandmaster games with this move and about 200 games with all the other moves together, combined together. So the only move you can play is knight d to b5. Now, this variation is called the Lasker-Pelikan variation, or it used to be called, as I said. Some people still refer to this system as the Lasker-Pelikan, and the Sveshnikov is only one variation of that. But today, this whole system, this thing with e5 on move 5 for black and knight d to b5 is called the Sveshnikov. So here, the line is pretty straightforward. Black doesn't want to allow this, doesn't want to trade his bishop pair, because if white manages to check on d6, then bishop takes, queen takes. White has too much of a bind on the position. The other knight is coming into b5, you're threatening knight c7 checks, knight d6 once again, and this just can't be allowed. So the only move for black here is pawn to d6. Let me flip the board for those of you playing with the black pieces. So d6, this is the only move you can play. The only way to prevent knight to d6 is to put the pawn there, because it's now defended twice. White continues with bishop to g5, pinning the knight, threatening to get his knight into d5. As I said, this is the main weakness in black's position, and this move, bishop to g5, indirectly attacks the d5 square. You are basically removing the defender, because the knight is pinned to the queen. And now the thematic pawn push, a6, chasing the knight away. The knight doesn't have any squares except for knight to a3, and this is where the position branches out. This is the starting position of the Sveshnikov Sicilian. You might think that the knight is misplaced, and it sort of is for the moment, but as I said, white has a plan to get this knight back into the game. So the plan is as follows. If black didn't do anything, you would do this. Knight to d5, probably trade here, play c3, then knight to c2, knight to e3, knight to d5. This is your plan. Remove the knight from c3, play c3, then transfer the knight from a3 to d5 or to e3 if you want to control f5 as well. So this is your plan. This knight is actually great here, because you can get it from c2 into e3 and then either control f5, either put the knight on f5 or to d5, or simply leave it on e3 to control both the key squares in the position. And these holes are actually horrible. This slight squared bishop is still defending f5, but there really isn't anything contesting the d5 square. From here on, there are two variations. One of them is b5, which is the main line, and the other one is bishop to e6, which is referred to as the bird variation of the Sveshnikov. We are going to go over that first. So, bishop to e6. After bishop to e6, white has one good move, basically. Not transferring the knight from c2 to d5, but playing knight to c4 and then going into e3 that way. You have time to do that, basically, because the other variation with b5 doesn't give you that option, which you would like to use. And of course, after bishop to e6, you don't have to do this whole thing. Firstly, your knight would be captured here, but you don't have to do this whole maneuver. You can simply play knight to c4, and if white wants to waste the tempo to get rid of your knight, sure, give up the bishop pair, sure. So after this, black has one best move, which is rook to c8. And here the engines give the position as +1 for white. Let me turn on the engine just so you can see that. You can see that on the right side of the board. But that's really not true. The engines over-exaggerate advantages in positions like this. In fact, if you let it run a little deeper, it's going to diminish the advantage. But still, it's too big of an advantage objectively. So after rook to c8, white's best and only move is to remove the defender of d5, so bishop takes f6. Now here is where the bird variation of the Sveshnikov branches out. You have two options. You can take with the g-pawn, you can take with the queen. I think both moves have been played equally often. Both moves have around 10,000 games from or 5,000 games from this position. So they're good. Both moves are good, but they're quite different. Let's go over queen takes first. So queen takes f6. You don't double your pawns on the f-file, which is what you have to concede to most often in the Sveshnikov, and black has to accept the fact that he's going to have doubled f-pawns. Now, on the other hand, you can push through with f5 and weaken the control of the center by removing the pawn on e4, but yeah, we are going to get to that. So queen takes f6. Knight to b6, threatening the rook, gaining a tempo, rook to b8. And now knight c to d5, and you can see that these holes have actually been amplified by the queen going away from b6, because once the queen was on d8, it was controlling the b6 square. And now you can't really do anything to remove the knights from d5, and white has a central bind. Queen to d8 now, putting the queen back, c3, not allowing the black knight from entering the center. Bishop to e7, developing. Bishop to c4, strengthening the grip on d5. As I said, as in most Sicilians, the game is going to revolve around the d5 square, and especially in the Sveshnikov Sicilian. This is probably the most thematic Sicilian variation there is, because all lines and all variations revolve around the d5 square. So bishop c4, castles, bishop to g5, getting the bishop on a more active diagonal, a4, trying to put even more control over the center and over the queen side. King to h8, queen to e2, and now g6. And black is, as you can see, preparing to push through with f5, gaining some counterplay. White is trying to get a queen side pawn avalanche. White has more central control, but as I said, the position is basically equal. Engines give white an edge always in most Sicilians, and objectively having such a big hole on d5 is a weakness, but yeah, it's nothing major. And the Sveshnikov with bishop to e6 on move 8, the bird variation, remains a very powerful defense for white. Now, this is what would happen if you take with the queen. One more thing I want to highlight about the Sveshnikov Sicilian. I think it's an opening which is really straightforward and easy to learn. Much easier than, let's say, the Neidorf, because most lines are forcing, and this line, for example, with queen takes f6, there aren't that many alternatives for either side. So knight to b6 is the best move. You want to control d5. Rook b8, you're still defending your b7 pawn. Knight c to d5, a very logical move. Queen to d8, the queen was attacked, move the queen. c3, not allowing the knight to enter the position. Bishop to e7, developing. Bishop to c4, strengthening the grip on d5. Castles. All the moves are logical, and even over the board, if you didn't know the variation, you would probably find all of these moves. So the Sveshnikov is straightforward and easy to learn. So that's why I think it's a valuable opening to have in your repertoire, because you could hardly get a worse position out of the opening, even against a much stronger opponent. So let's go back. So bishop to e6, the bird variation. Knight c4, rook c8, bishop takes f6. We just took with the queen in the previous line. Let's take with the g pawn now. This is I would say a better move because it's more aggressive, and I prefer this move. Now, there are two things white could do here, basically. White could either play bishop to d3 or knight to e3, and the difference is only slight. Knight to e3 is the main move, and now bishop to h6, attacking the knight, and you are most often going to get this knight, and you want to trade your dark squared bishop for this knight because it controls central squares. Bishop to d3. Bishop takes e3, f takes e3, queen to b6, attacking both pawns, and now queen to c1, defending both pawns. Now, the difference is that in this variation after gf6, where you don't play knight to e3, but you play bishop to d3 first, is that after knight to e7, knight to e3, bishop to h6, you can now castle, and after bishop takes e3, f takes e3, queen to b6, you can play queen to f3, attacking the f6 pawn, not caring about the b pawn. And now if queen takes b2, then simply knight to d5, and your position is perfect. I think this is a big advantage for white. The engines give it as plus 1.2, and there are still some games from this position, but I think white has too big of an advantage here, and this shouldn't really be played. If you continue the line, bishop takes, e takes d5, f5. Black does have some chances on the king side, but I think it's not enough, and I think white's position is just much easier to play. So after bishop to d3, knight to e7, knight to e3, bishop h6, castles. Taking here isn't really that good because after queen b6, of course, white is going to defend the e3 pawn, but you don't really care about your b pawn because you can always play knight to d5. And that's why I think that after g takes f6, most players with white will play bishop to d3 because it's simply a better move. Knight to e3, bishop h6 does allow black a much stronger queen to b6. So let's say bishop d3, bishop takes, f takes, queen b6. Queen to c1 is usually played here. Let's see. If queen to f3 is played here, let's see what the problem is. Your rook is hanging. Sorry. Yeah. I forgot about that. Okay, so yeah, the difference is that once you castle, you can play queen to f3. If you don't castle, then queen to c1 has to be played because after queen takes b2, both your knight and your rook are hanging. So yeah, queen to c1. And here, black's main move is h5. And after h5, white should castle nevertheless, putting pressure on the f6 square. And after rook h6, king h1, knight to e7. The position is more comfortable for black. But still, I think that it's easier to play for white, and white objectively has an advantage despite having double central pawns. Black has doubled f pawns, and white's doubled pawns actually control more key squares, and I think this is just a better position for white. So this is what you would get after bishop takes e6, and it's almost unavoidable. So knight c4, rook c8, bishop takes f6, g takes f6 is very aggressive. And as I said, you are going to get either a position like this or a position like this. So in either case, you have to be prepared to play the position with your king in the center and with doubled f pawns. So if you find that too risky, after bishop takes f6, take with the queen and still concede to a slightly worse position with slightly less space, but safer, I would say. So this is what you get after bishop to e6. And this might be the reason why bishop to e6 is not the main line. And I would actually recommend the other move, which we are going to go over now. So after d6, bishop to g5, a6, knight to a3. We just went over bishop to e6, the bird variation. The main move and objectively the best move is b5. And now you can see the first difference, the most obvious difference is that the knight doesn't have the c4 square and that the knights are threatened. So one of the knights has to move or something has to be done in order not to lose a piece. This is the main move. And this is the Sveshnikov Sicilian. This is the Sveshnikov variation of the Sveshnikov Sicilian, if you want to call it that. The moves after 5, e5 for black are still called the Lasker-Pelikan or the Sveshnikov, but this is the Sveshnikov variation of the Sveshnikov or the Sveshnikov variation of the Lasker-Pelikan. Okay, white has two moves. White can either take the knight on f6 or put the knight on d5 immediately. Now the knight is pinned. Of course, so after knight to d5, which is the main line, the knight can't take. But let's go over the sideline first. The sideline is bishop takes f6, and after bishop takes f6, you never take with the queen here, because of knight to d5, which is much stronger here, you take with the g-pawn. And after knight to d5, you have two options. You can either play f5 to immediately dissolve your weakness, or you can play bishop to g7. They are quite different. Let's go over both. The main move is f5. So after f5, you want to get rid of your doubled pawn. You're challenging white center and trying to remove the e4 pawn from the equation. So bishop to d3, defending e4. Bishop e6, castles. And now bishop takes d5. You take the very strong central knight. And once bishop takes d5, e takes d5 has been played, the hole on d5 isn't such a big problem anymore. Because If a piece is put on a weak square, then the weakness of the square is amplified. And if a pawn occupies the square, then the weakness is dampened. And you don't really feel the consequences of the weakness anymore because the pawn can't do anything in your position. It's blockaded by the d-pawn. And this actually solves both of black's problems. Both the weak d5 square and the backward d6 pawn, which is now much harder to attack once there is a pawn in front of it. That's why I think this is the best line for black, and I think black should play this line. basically. I think this is the best move. If bishop takes f6 is played instead of knight to d5. So bishop takes f6, g takes f6, knight to d5, f5. And after bishop d3 defending the pawn, let's just say that taking here isn't good because you allow black to develop with tempo and black is fine. Bishop d3, bishop e6, castles. Bishop takes d5, e takes d5, knight to e7. Black is perfectly fine here. Even the engines think that the position is equal. Now all of a sudden, white has a weakness on d5. And black's king is much less safe than white's king. And black is behind in development, but black is perfectly fine. Black has a strong center. Even the double f pawns are useful here, and black is fine. Now from this position on, after knight to e7, white has two options. White can win a pawn temporarily, with knight takes b5. Let's go over that first. If a takes b5 is played, then you just lose the game because of bishop takes b5 check and you're forced to give up your knight, and that's just, well, we don't have to discuss this position. Knight takes b5, you don't take the knight, you concede to being a pawn down. So in this position, black has six pawns and white has seven pawns. You play bishop to g7. And after bishop to g7, the knight has to return. Knight to c3, e4, bishop to c4, knight to g6. And you have given up a pawn for a lot of activity. And you can see that this bishop is definitely a monster. It's much better than this bishop. This knight is coming into the key e5 square, and it can't really be dislodged because if f4 ampassant. So I would actually prefer to have black in this position, despite being a pawn down and despite having doubled pawns on the f-file. And the position continues queen to h5, putting pressure on the f5 pawn. Bishop takes c3, b takes c3, and queen to f6. Now, the engines think white is slightly better, but black is perfectly fine. So this is what happens after knight takes b5 on move 14. There's another move, though. After e takes d5, knight to e7, you don't have to play knight takes b5. There's a safer move for white, and that's the move c3. And after c3, you don't allow black that much activity, and you don't win a pawn. So you can either choose to win a pawn and give activity to black or not do that. It depends on your style of play. After c3, black continues with bishop to g7, queen to h5 once again, putting pressure on f5, e4, bishop to e2, castles. You castle despite not having a g pawn, it's safe. There aren't really that many pieces black can attack with. Knight to c2, rook to c8, knight to e3, f4. And you are utilizing your doubled f pawns as much as you can, of course. You are putting pressure on white's king side, and you are going to get your knight to g6, and all of your pieces are going to harmonically attack white's king. So I think this is the reason why the Sveshnikov Sicilian is so popular, because it just gives black a lot of activity without too much trouble, actually. And in these lines, with bishop takes f6, I think black is fine. I think black is much better than when white doesn't take on f6 immediately. But okay, so knight to f5 here, rook to e8, a4, knight to g6, ab5, ab5, bishop b5, rook to e5. And there's a very interesting game, Peter Leko against Sergei Karjakin, when Karjakin was very young. I'm not sure what the year was. Let me check. Okay, Karjakin, Leko from 2004. Peter Leko was black in this position, and he defeated Karjakin in a marvelous fashion. I would advise you to look at that game. I mean, to be honest, Karjakin was 2500 then, and Leko was 2700 something, so it's not that uncommon, but still a very instructive game. So, okay, we are going to stop here with rook to e5. There are still about 20 or 30 games from this position on. This is still theory for grandmasters, but let's move on. Okay, so that was the move f5. After knight to d5, f5. Sorry, f5. We are going to go over one more move. Instead of f5, bishop to g7 can be played as well. And after bishop to g7, bishop d3, knight to e7, knight takes e7, queen takes e7, castles, castles, c4, f5. And I'm not a big fan of this variation. I think it's much better to play f5 immediately. Because now you still have a weakness here. And it, to be honest, it's tough for the white knight to get in there. But knight c2, knight e3, knight d5. And you didn't get rid of your weak d6 pawn, you didn't get rid of your weakness on d5, so I would much prefer the move f5 to the move bishop to g7. So yeah, f5 immediately dissolving your weaknesses, and there isn't really that much white can do to avoid that. You are giving up your light squared bishop, but that doesn't really matter. So in positions with knight to a3 and bishop takes f6, knight to a3, b5, and bishop takes f6, I think black stands fine. Now let's go over the main line. After b5, the main move isn't bishop takes f6, is the move knight to d5. And I think this is the most challenging way to play, and I think this is the toughest variation for black to face. So knight to d5, and once again, as I said, the line is fairly straightforward and easy to learn. The moves you're about to see have been mainline theory since probably the early 2000s, and not much has changed since the 70s even, and there aren't that many branches you need to learn. So bishop to e7, developing your bishop, defending your knight twice, of course. Bishop takes f6 now, bishop takes f6, c3. Castles, and now the thematic maneuver, knight c2, knight to e3, so knight to c2, bishop to g5, getting your bishop on a more active diagonal, removing it so that the knight can't capture, and now we continue with a4, putting pressure on black's queen side, b takes a4, always take, rook takes a4, a5. Yeah, bishop to c4, putting more pressure on the d5 square, rook b8, b3, defending the pawn, king h8, knight c2, e3, g6, and this is what you will normally get. Unfortunately, you have to learn about 20 moves of theory. Fortunately, there aren't that many variations you have to learn. So, okay, let's go over that once again. Bishop to e7, black develops the bishop. Now white captures, because now black was threatening to take on d5, and as I said, if black captures, then white would have to capture with the queen, and then bishop to e6 is a tempo. And if white captures with the e4 pawn, you have just helped black defend his d6 pawn and get rid of the d5 weakness. So bishop f6, bishop f6, c3, castles, knight c2, the thematic maneuver, bishop g5, a4, gaining space on the queen side, takes, a5, bishop c4, putting pressure on d5, rook b8 attacking, b3 defending, king h8, getting away from the diagonal, and preparing to play f5, which was hard to do. If you play f5 here, then you lose something. Knight c3, g6, and strengthening the f5 push. Now here, you have two variations to choose from as white. Let's go over one aggressive sideline first, and that's the move h4. h4 gives up a pawn, that's clear, and black has to take it. If he doesn't take, then he's just worse. So bishop takes h4, g3. Bishop to g5, f4. And you could argue whether the pawn sacrifice is justified or not. I think it is. And you are giving up a pawn for a lot of activity. White has 5 pawns, black has 6. But black's a5 pawn is weak. Black's h7 pawn is a permanent weakness. And black's bishop has to run away. So the h4 move is definitely aggressive and justified. I would prefer that to the main line. So bishop takes h4, g3, bishop g5, f4, and e takes f4, g takes f4, bishop h4, check. Your king goes to d2, but that doesn't really matter. You have a lot of pressure on black's king, and you can imagine several pieces coming into the position, and it's very easy for black to get in trouble here. Knight e7 is the best defensive try, queen to g1. Knight takes d5. As black here, you want to get rid of as many pieces as possible. Knight takes d5, bishop e6, trying to exchange once again. Queen to h2, g5. So, yeah, this is where I would like to stop with the h4 variation. You can see what you can expect from that. As white, you are going to have to justify your pawn sacrifice. If you let black exchange off too many pieces, you aren't going to have that much. And as white, you want to attack as soon as possible. So yeah, but let's go to the main line. After g6, the main line isn't to play h4, it's to castle. And this is considered to be safer, and there are more games from this position. Now, since black has been preparing the move f5 for the last several moves with g6 and king to h8, now black is of course going to play f5. Queen to d3, defending the e4 pawn. You never really want to take and develop black's bishop from c8. bishop to e6, rook to d1. After bishop to e6, you could take now, and then allow the bishop to take, but then your queen isn't really useful on d3 anyway. So it's not similar to positions in the Semislav, where you wait for the bishop to develop and then take d takes c4 and play b5. It's not similar to that. Your queen isn't really useful on d3. Rook d1, queen to d7, f3, f4. And after knight to c2, this is still theory. The position is completely equal. In fact, the engines give it as 0, 0, 0, 0. And yeah, both sides have something to play for. And black is sort of playing for a King's Indian type of position, pushing through on the king side and using his wall of pawns in that way. And white will want to get activity on the queen side, push through a passed pawn if possible, and try to put pressure on black that way. So yeah, this is where I would like to stop with the main line. With black, you have to be prepared for several things, and with white you need to be prepared for the move bishop to e6, which I think is not as good as the main line b5. So yeah, as black I would advise you to study both, but to play b5 against stronger opponents. And as white, you need to be prepared for bishop to e6, because you have to know how to get a slightly better position. And with b5, you need to be aware that black is perfectly fine if he plays well, and you don't even have you don't have any advantage if black plays correctly. Okay, this is what I wanted to go over. I hope you got to learn something about the Sveshnikov Sicilian. I hope I managed to explain things properly. I hope I didn't go too fast or too slow or too in-depth or not enough in-depth. And I hope you got to learn something today. Thanks very much for watching. Let me know what you think, and stay tuned for more chess. See you later. Bye-bye.